Good morning. Welcome to Hillhurst United Church. I am Keith Murray, the social justice ministry lead here. And over here, you'll see your affirming dog, Dolly. Say hi, Dolly. Yeah. And we are so excited to welcome you this morning to Hillhurst United Church. I wanted to welcome you from a place that nurtures my soul and growth, as today we talk about the fourth letter in the rain, nurture. And what I'm here to do this morning is to acknowledge these lands on which we gather to worship. Wherever you are joining us from online, please share in the chat the lands that you're connected with. Here, Hillhurst United Church is on Tsuut'ina land, Stony Nakoda land, on Blackfoot land, and on land that has been gathered and shared by many different nations over many years prior to contact from settlers. And it is a blessing and a real gift to be able to gather on these lands together with so many different cultures and identities, and to learn and grow from each other. You know, this week I was looking at an astrology chart, which was interesting. And I noticed that, you know, you have these 12 signs of the zodiac, and they all belong in this wheel. Like a color wheel has all of the colors, and they all belong. And so I think, you know, being an affirming community of faith is kind of like that. We're a community that acknowledges that we may look different. We may love differently. We may think differently. We may have different ways of praying, different ways of talking. Yet all of us are on this earth, on this great wheel that spins through space, and the sun shines on us equally. And, you know, at the intersection of the zodiac, like the intersection of the medicine wheel, which acknowledges the four races of the earth, there's the cross. And at the center is Christ, the intersection of heaven and earth. And we gather today to celebrate this beautiful place where we meet together. And in the spirit of love and welcome, welcome to that place where we can grow in our spirit together. Have a happy Sunday.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship at Hillhurst United Church. Maybe it's morning where you are. Maybe it's afternoon. It might even be midnight. I don't know what time you like to worship, but we're glad you're here. My name is Andrea Irwin, and I'm the associate minister here.
And Yates-Laberge, I'm the executive director.
And we are glad to be with you. Here at Hillhurst, we have four core values that we practice. Those are hospitality, spirituality, social justice, and risk. And we say that to you in case you've forgotten, or in case you are new to this community and you want to know who the people are you're worshiping with. We take putting those values into practice very seriously. So that's who you're sitting with: people that love spirituality, that love hospitality, that love social justice, and that are willing to put up with a little bit of risk.
A little bit of risk. Speaking of risk.
It was an unintentional segue.
Good segue, but I wanted to just update you on a couple of things. You may have received an email earlier this week around our COVID protocols that are in place. Our phase three program was rolled out by our board of directors in November of last year. And after the decisions of the government, we have decided we are actually going to stay on the path. In that plan, it's a plan that's based on safety. It's based on the care of our community and neighbors. And it's based on the fact that we really want to have some stability in coming back, and our staff and volunteers and everybody really ready to come back into this building. So I wanted to let you know that we actually internally are in phase two. Today is our first day, which is very exciting, that we actually have tech people in the back. We have tech people over here. We have some musicians in the building. So we're actually moving forward with our plans so that we can actually come back and everybody's ready feel really capable in their position. So if you did not receive that mail, please go to hillhurstunited.life and sign up for the newsletter. It's really important that you sign up for that newsletter, because it really is the heartbeat of the news right away when it happens, so that you can know what's going on.
Yeah, and we know that some of you will have some questions about that or want to engage in further conversation. So we invite you, in part for that reason, to join us at the congregational meeting on February 24th. This is a meeting that we have a couple times a year where we get together and we talk about all the updates in the community. We talk about big subject matter. This time we're talking about budget, and we're also giving some updates about the life of the church and some staff. And we do ask that everyone can come. No restrictions on that. But it's on Zoom and we ask that you register ahead of time. So that's at hillhurstunited.life. In other news, we have the heart of Hillhurst back again this year. It's beautiful. We have, who made it?
Bob and Nancy Watts.
Bob and Nancy, thank you. It's a great wooden heart in front of the church that you can come and take selfies with. But in addition to that, we have Valentine's Day cards that we are inviting you to write to seniors and essential workers in the neighborhood. So we ask that you can make those at home and you can drop them off in our mail slot. There's a sign, you'll see it's very clear where to drop them off. And come and get your picture taken at the heart. You can tag us with the hashtag #HeartOfHillhurst. And thank you so much to the Connections team for organizing all of that. You can see we had fun in the heart.
We had a lot of fun in the heart, yes. So part of the plan of coming back is we can't do this without volunteers and people stepping up to serve in the church. Fun fact, it takes about 30 people behind the scenes and in front of the scenes. That's not a real word, but anyway, it takes 30 people to put on a Sunday service in this place. Yeah. And we are actually moving towards training these teams. And there's many, many, many teams. I'm going to show you a screen of all the teams because I will mess up and leave one out, but there's lots of teams. I'd like you to sign up. The big part of this is that you don't actually have to be local and in this sanctuary to be part of a team. We have a prayer team that's happening online, hosting, and community care, which we are actually extending out into our bigger community. We're stepping into what it means to be here
physically
and online. So being very intentional about that. So whether you've been here or not, please take an opportunity to look at that. If you really don't know, like, I don't know where my gifts really are, fill out the form and you and I will have a chat around how we can get you in here. Being on a team is really a part of a little smaller ministry too. And it's a really good part to learn about the church too.
Yeah. We look forward to working with you. Last but not least, this morning, afternoon, evening is Communion Sunday or Communion Wednesday, depending on when you're joining us. And tomorrow is St. Valentine's Day, the Feast of St. Valentine's. So we are having an agape meal. We invite you now to take a moment just before worship starts to gather whatever you would like to share in this meal with. That could be toast. It's my preference. It could be grapes. It could be orange juice. It could be your goldfish crackers. The list goes on. Take a moment, gather those things, and we will give you the instructions when the time comes. But for now, happy Sunday.
Happy Sunday.
Let us build a house where love can dwell and all can safely live. A place where saints and children faith and vault of grace, in the love of Christ shall end divisions. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where prophets speak and words are strong and true, where all God's children dare to seek to dream. Symbol of God's grace. You as one, we claim the faith of Jesus. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where love is found in water, wine, and wheat. A banquet hall on holy ground where peace and through Jesus is revealed in time and space as we share in Christ the feast that frees us. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where hands will reach beyond the wood and stone to heal and strengthen, serve and teach and live the word they've known.
This week is the final week of our rain series that we've been doing in worship. And rain, for those of you who haven't been joining us on this journey, is a practice of mindfulness developed by Tara Brach, who is a Buddhist meditation teacher and psychologist. And rain is a practice by which we can center ourselves, we can come into stillness no matter what we're experiencing in the outer world, and really cultivate a sense of self-compassion. And it's an acronym, so this is how you can remember it. R stands for recognize, A stands for allow, I for investigate, and this week we are settling into the final step of nurture. So when we come together like this, whether you are with us in real time or watching us later, part of what we do is recognize all that we are bringing with us into this space. So what's happening in the world, in our country, in our very own backyard, we bring with us into this space. And we allow ourselves to bring it all here and to investigate together how we might be able to hold that weight differently. And so we take all of our hurt and our anger and the fear that we might be feeling in the midst of all that is going on. And there is a lot going on. The Freedom Convoy, the news from the Alberta government, the ever-changing way of life and our life that just keeps on happening in the midst of all of it. And we bring that here to hold it together and to hold it with God. And we call that worship. We call that liturgy, if we want a new vocab word for the day. And liturgy simply means the work of the people. And so today, in the face of all that is, we come together to find nurture amongst our people. Whoever you are, wherever you're at, you are those people. So today's worship, it might have a bit of a different flow to it. And we invite you, despite the fact it might not be what you're used to, we invite you to allow it to nurture you. We'll be hearing from 6 different voices this morning, all about what nurtures them and what or how that practice helps them live out nurture in the world outside of this place. We'll hear from William Brook, the leader of our contemplative ministries. We'll hear from Lori Follis, a congregant and our lay music advisor. We'll hear from Jaden Bryant, one of our Hillhurst youth, who's a high school senior this year. It's a big deal. We'll hear from Jolta Detus, one of our lay leaders and member of worship planning, Clorinda Bryant, a congregant nurse and the mother to Jaden, and we'll hear from Robin Kidd, our lead of congregational care, retired teacher, and as I learned this week, a deliverer of fabulous cookies. So I invite you to again just adopt a spirit of receiving this morning. Allow yourself to be nurtured. And let us now join together in worship.
Good morning. Given the chance, I might well choose to live my life inside my head. I buy more books than I can ever read. I have so many books going on at once, stacked on my bedside table and littered throughout my house, that I lose track of what I'm reading. There's always another podcast, another news story, Twitter, Facebook. It's a world full of delicious information, and I am insatiable. Left to my own devices, I will be plugged into something, reading something, or searching for something to read or to plug into. And when I'm not plugged in, I can be captivated by an inner dialogue of ideas, daydreams, imagined conversations, not to mention self-judgment, catalogs of regret, and other obsessive thoughts. And sometimes this is harmless, or even beneficial. All this thinking has its place. But during difficult or uncertain times like these that we're living through now, or during times of family crisis or work stress, my churning active mind would try to fix problems for which there was really no solution other than just to let them unfold as they will. And this was hard. I could be anxious and reactive. I wanted to be in control, and I was often consumed by racing, frantic thoughts. I would feel it in my body, losing sleep, and my back going into spasm. And over the years, I tried different solutions, some of them healthy, some of them self-destructive. But what's helped the most and what has stuck for me is a simple practice of silence and presence. Every day, I do something called centering prayer, where I sit still and silent for 20 to 30 minutes. And centering prayer is one of several meditation practices. And what they have in common is that you learn to let go of your thoughts. You learn to stop judging your thoughts, and you learn to stop telling yourself stories about them. And in time, you become aware that you are not your thoughts. And slowly but surely, the habits that you learn in silent prayer begin to seep into your life, and you notice that your mind is a little bit less busy, a little bit less frantic. Now, I'm by no means perfect. I still obsess, and I plug in too much. But I think this practice has helped me to get out of my head and to be more grounded in my body. I'm more attentive to what's actually happening as opposed to what I imagine or what I fear. And I'm more present in my relationships and in my life. And it's this presence that is important. And for me, this is the true gift of a practice of silence. Now, centering prayer has its roots in medieval monasteries where monks and nuns would sit in silent prayer and simply open themselves up with what they called a naked intent to the presence of God. And these mothers and fathers of the mystical tradition, they taught us that God is everywhere in the world, that there's nothing that is not sacred, and that everything belongs, and that we are not alone. And I think everybody has glimpses of the holy in their life. They have moments where they feel the midst of the divine in their midst. And the practice of silence allows me to be present to what is beyond the grasp of my mind. So now I'm going to invite you into a brief meditation, a brief time of silence. I want to invite you into a time simply of breathing and being, just a gentle time of presence and stillness. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to lead you through a brief meditation, and then I'm going to ring a bell, and we're going to sit just in a very gentle silence for a few moments. I'll ring a bell again, and then we'll come back into the worship. So I invite you to find in your home or wherever you are a comfortable place to sit. And just sit with your feet planted firmly on the ground in front of you, connecting you, grounding you to the earth. And just sit tall and straight, but relaxed. And you can just rest your hands gently on your lap. And I invite you to take in a deep breath. And as we breathe out slowly, I just invite you to let go. Let go of your anxieties. Let go of any of the obsessive thoughts that may have kept you up in the middle of the night. And just let's breathe in again deeply once more. And as we breathe out slowly, just take a few moments to rest your attention on your breath and on your body. Notice the sensation of breathing in. Notice the sensation of breathing out. The simple act that we all perform every minute of every day, that nurtures us and that connects us to the universe. And just notice as you breathe that your body will come into stillness. And just pay attention. And if you're feeling any discomfort anywhere, you should feel free to shift and let yourself be as comfortable as possible. And just pay attention. Notice this morning what it's like to be you. Notice what's on your heart today. And as you come into stillness and into quiet, you'll notice that thoughts will begin to arise in your mind. And you can welcome them. And don't judge them. And don't resist them or attach to them. Just simply notice them. Let them go. And return to your breathing. It doesn't matter how many times you have to do this to return again and again to your breath. That's just fine. Your mind may be still. Your mind may be very busy. But whatever you do this morning will be enough. It'll be more than enough. Just remember that as you are, your truest identity, your truest self, is that you are a beloved child of God, just as you are, no matter what. So now that we're still and we're entering a gentle silence, I just invite you to be open and to be present to whatever may arise in you this morning. Now I'm going to say a few words from Psalm 46. I'm going to ring the bell, and then we'll sit in silence for a few moments. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know. Be still. Be. As you bring your attention back into the space where you are, know this morning that all shall be well. Know this morning that we are not alone. Blessings to you for this worship day.
I am loved. Let me love.
does it mean to nurture yourself?
Means to like practice self-care. And like, for me, that's like stuff like when I get ready in the morning, I do my hair, my makeup. I get dressed, I get into like nice outfits. And that's just how I don't know, like that's how I nurture myself.
What does it mean when you nurture others?
Asking them questions about themselves. I don't know, just helping other people out, I guess.
What do you think that nurturing looks like at Hillhurst?
There's like a lot of the like community programs and like the community fridge and whatnot. Just helping the general community, I guess.
I am loved. Let me
helping the community and the wider world is something that we do very well here at Hillhurst. And you heard Jaden mention a couple of the ways that we nurture those around us. And one of the ways that was mentioned earlier was the community cupboard. But there are a multitude of ways that we feed others and are fed in return. And one of the ways that you can nurture these kinds of programs, and there are many of them, is through financial giving to this community. So we encourage you to think about how that might fit into the way that you understand nurture and explore all of the different ways that you can do that on our website. And we pray that all the gifts that this community receives nurture 100-fold.
I love baking because I've been doing it since before I can even really remember. Mostly what I remember is watching my mom and my grandma bake. And then as soon as I could, I started, I took home ec in school. I loved baking. I loved the smell. I loved the eating of the baking. I loved the sharing of the baking. And so it's been a love of mine forever. But for sourdough bread, that intrigued me about 5 years ago when I watched a series on Netflix called Cooked. And the creator of this series is Michael Pollan, and he does it into four parts. And the specific part that I was really captivated by was called Air. And in that, I discovered that flour, water, and a bit of salt combined can turn into a delicious loaf of bread. And it turns out that best they know, in ancient Egypt, a bowl of porridge was left out for a few days. And when it was discovered, it was starting to kind of bubble and ferment. And that was kind of the first starter. So I started my bread dough and bread starter and sourdough journey. And the first thing that I learned through my study was that you should name your starter. So my two grandmas are Gladys and Annie, and I loved both of them. Gladys was a baker, and Annie, I think she pretty much survived on tea and toast. So I was like, I've got to name it after them. So my starter, here she is. It's called Gladys Ann, and I talk to her and I love her, and she bubbles. And when she bubbles and does what she's supposed to do, I get super excited. In fact, I think I pretty much developed a relationship with her. And over learning how to make the bread and taking the time, you really start to form a relationship with it. And I found out that bread is also the word for life, which kind of makes sense to me because really a loaf of bread is very sustaining. And it's also alive before you even bake it because the yeast is growing in there. And I found that super fascinating. And it's painstaking and you can't rush the process. And I love that about it. It's become a rhythm in my life. It, you know, there's been different times over the last 5 years when, you know, I've been so excited to bake the bread and it's become the day of the week that I bake bread. Even my friends will say to me, oh, isn't it bread day today? And I love the feel of the bread. I love watching it change. I love when I smell it baking in the oven. I love, cracking into it and taking that first cut so I can open it up and see the bubbles and slather butter on it, take a first bite. I make 2 loaves a week. And Kim and I, my husband and I, we pretty much just eat the 1 loaf. And it's become a habit of ours now, the two of us, to figure out who are we going to give the second loaf to this week. So it not only feeds and nurtures us and nurtures me in the practice, I get a chance to hopefully nurture someone else by giving it to them. And the practice has changed along the way. Because I've done it for so long, my bread days have been marked by different times in my life, like when COVID started and I was already in the practice and habit of making bread, I was able to mark my weeks and have that consistency and the joy of making bread. So for me, bread making is, I guess it's a bit of a spiritual practice and it does nurture me. And I'm really grateful that I've found sourdough bread and I love the practice of making bread and getting to eat it and getting to share it.
I am loved. Let me love. I am loved. Let me love. Breathe.
So, Andrea, here we are on the Nurture Sunday. And when we were thinking about nurture, we thought about food. There are many ways that we get nurtured. Some people are nurtured in music or art or poetry. I get nurtured on a bike. How do you get nurtured?
I like to take a seat outside and write until there are no words left in me.
Beautiful. And this table is set as a place of nurture. And you can see we've got here grapes, chocolate. Oop, I forgot coffee.
Still warm.
Still warm coffee, bread, toast.
Toast. Holy toast, actually.
Pomegranate.
Smarties.
We were saving that for last. Chocolate chips, goldfish, and crackers. And of course, the Bible. But here's the deal. This is spread out. We know wherever you are, it might be nighttime and you're having a nighttime snack. You might be Sunday morning and you're having your coffee and muffin. But food is one of the things that nurtures us. We have a comfort food. Mine would be bread and yours would be?
The toast right there, preferably with some cheese on it.
Cheese and toast. Nice. Well, mine would be toast, cheese, and jam. Which
jam with your cheese?
It is. That's just my thing.
Okay.
So here we are at this table, and we're fully aware that bread in the Bible is so symbolic of life. In the Hebrew story of the people in the wilderness, when they are grumbling and complaining and tired and hungry, God sends manna from the heavens, which is bits of like a moist bread that feeds them for their journey. Later on, Jesus, we know, ate and drank with people in their homes, in the hospital, by the water, on the top of a mountain. And then before he died, he wanted people to remember him. And he was so wise. He linked food and memory and story. So they're having this big feast, as you know. They're all chit-chatting, telling stories. He gathers their attention, asks for the bread to be passed. And he gets the quiet of the room and he raises up the bread and he says, "This is my body broken for you. Each time you eat this, remember me." and he breaks the bread before their eyes. You can almost hear the bread being broken, and he invites them to take a piece of this bread. Jesus called himself the bread of life, for it was his body and his stories that fed people for the journey. And then?
And then following that, there was likely beverages on the table. And Jesus took that beverage, maybe it was wine. He took a cup and he poured it out. And he said, do this in remembrance of me. God's love poured out.
So this is the body of Christ, bread for the journey.
And this is the cup of Christ, God's love poured out. So we ask this morning that the Holy One send your spirit over these gifts, over all of our gifts, wherever we are, whatever we are eating. Bless these to our nourishment. Amen.
So we invite the Lord's Prayer now?
Yeah, let's sing the Lord's Prayer together.
Bread for the journey.
And God's love poured out. We invite you to take your elements and to eat with us.
The best part.
Spirit, we give thanks that your spirit nurtures us on our journey. We give thanks for the food we have shared this day and the communion through online and present community. May you continue to nurture us, that we be your hands, feet, and voice in the world. Help us to know we are loved, forgiven, and set free. Amen.
Amen.
I think of nurture, I think of care and comfort. I think of family, friends, community, and loved ones. I think of storytelling and story sharing, of Haitian elders, aunts, uncles, gathering little ones around the cup of Haitian hot chocolate, telling bedtime stories, assuring anxious little ones that everything will be okay. Despite hurricanes, floods, political instability, lack of access to education, and so much more, these little ones are being fed, nurtured by the older folks in their lives, filling their heads with optimism and dreams for the future. When I was a little girl growing up on the amazing islands of the Caribbean, I was nurtured in the most unconventional way. Hair care. I would sit on the laps of my aunties and older cousins as they would spend hours parting, then soothing my scalp with homemade ointments to keep my curls moisturized, lush, and just perfect. As these older women parted intricate and elaborate patterns in my hair, which their grandmothers parted in their hair, which their grandmothers parted in their hair, they would turn my head to allow them better precision as they created art. Art that was once upon a time used as maps for escape routes during the Haitian Revolution. They would use the fine tooth of a comb to create patterns for braids, twists, and plaits that would then be decorated with colorful ribbons, bubbles, and barrettes. While their hands are careful with the patterns, their lips are even more careful with the words that they're speaking over me, over my future, over my life. You see, in my culture, hair is sacred. And so we are careful as to who touch our hair, but we are even more careful as to who speaks over us. So as I'm sitting there being nurtured spiritually and physically, I listen to the words being spoken over me. I listen to the stories I'm being told, but most importantly, I'm listening to the lessons I'm being taught about myself, my family, my community, about the lessons about generations of rice farmers and how they make it year after year, not knowing if the rain will come or if too much rain will come. Not knowing if they'll be able to sell all of their crops, but they're still hanging on. They're still looking forward. They're still planting grains of rice, still planting corn, hoping that the rain will come, though not too much rain, but not too little rain either. That they may be able to sell their crops and send me off to school so that one day I will be able to send money back home to them, or one day have them sit before me as I part their hair, grease their scalp, and braid their really curly gray hair into long braids or twists or plaits. And I'll give them kisses on their foreheads and ask them how they like the way I've done their hair. Their hands are now too feeble to braid their own hair, and so these older aunties and cousins of mine are being nurtured by me, as they once nurtured me. And just like that, we keep it going. Me speaking words of longer days over them, of strength in their olden days, of smiles to greet their grandkids, and of lessons that they have learned and passed on. You see, nurturing is care. Nurturing is comfort. Nurturing is community. It's family. It's loved ones. Nurturing is a spiritual and physical. It's water and a hug. It's a smile and a good morning. It's a helping hand and a donation. Nurturing is being the best of us.
I am seen. Let me see.
My first experience nurturing something. So I was in grade school and we were doing a project on the growth and development of baby chickens. So I watched them, their eggs in the incubator. I watched over them while they grew inside. I watched them peck through the little eggshell into the big world with their little wet feathers. And soon they grew and became little fluffy yellow chicks. And, but that nurturing didn't stop in the classroom. I continued on, nurturing in my own house with my personal chicken, much to my parents', dismay. And, eventually that chicken went to the farm, a physical farm, not the. So that was my first memory of that. I feel very nurtured because I have amazing, I have an amazing family. I'm very lucky. I have an amazing family, an amazing child who is so sweet. One thing that I love that he does to nurture me is if I'm, you know, watching a movie or something like that, he'll come into the room and he'll kiss me on the forehead. And I think that is the sweetest thing that a child can do to a mom, because especially when they're teenagers, they don't like to cuddle or do, you know, show affection. But I feel nurtured every day. I feel nurtured from my child. I feel nurtured from my family, my friends. I'm very lucky. I find that I'm a very lucky person. And I do, and in my job, I'm, you know, I have a boss that's amazing and coworkers that are incredible, and I love working with them, and I feel very just fulfilled every day. I used to be a newborn ICU nurse, so I worked in the hospital. So that was really easy, right? Really easy to nurture people because you have these little tiny babies and you would take care of them by changing their diaper and feeding them and turning them and handing them off to their mothers. And you would nurture the families by, you know, listening to them and helping them because they'd be scared to hold their babies for the first time. But now I have this job where I work from home, and nurturing to me can be like a little bit harder. But because of what our world is going through right now, we have a lot of ICU nurses that are going through a really rough time. So I think that part of my way of nurturing right now is to, when I speak to ICU nurses, I say like, hey, how's it going? And how are things in the ICU? you know, so, I think that's my way of finding a way to nurture someone like from a distance, because I at least can still listen to them and hear what's going on and how they're feeling and how they're doing. Two, I learned that there's such an amazing feeling when you care and nurture someone, that you get this, it's almost like a selfish thing on my part, I guess, because you get this feeling. It's a really great feeling that to me signifies interconnectedness and love between humans and humans and things and animals. And so I get this feeling that honestly, sometimes I feel like it's in my heart. It feels like it's just going to like run over, like my cup runneth over. And it does. It spills onto my hands, I always say. And I give that. I give that to people. That's what I give to people. And so, yeah, I think just those early days of nurturing chickens got me to nurture people and become a nurse.
I am loved. Let me love. I am loved. Let me love. Breathe.
Nurture, I guess, to me means a sense of being loved and held, and sharing that with other people, doing the same for them as is done to me. Because of COVID and other things, I don't always feel nurtured at this time. My granddaughter nurtures me, both of them do, but I don't see them as much as I'd like to. So it's a hard question. Mm-hmm. Friends nurture me, but again, I'm separated from them for a lot of the time too. When I was a child, I was lucky to have parents who loved and nurtured me, and we had a pretty strong family. But I went through a period of my life where I wasn't giving or accepting nurture from other people and chose to separate myself from the community, partly due to issues with alcohol and other things, but that was a very difficult time. So as I got older, and especially when I was teaching and having my own children, that sense of love and nurture became really a large part of my life. I think that my ability to nurture others came partly with my acceptance of who I was. And also with that came an acceptance of who other people are. So rather than looking at people and judging them, instead I felt a great sense of empathy with others. And I really enjoy having real conversations with people. I like being real. And that's what nurture does. When you nurture people, you're able to break down those social barriers and able to open your heart to them and just see them for who they are and what they have to offer to the world. My belief is that that is what our church and our spirituality is about, is being part of the world, not separating yourself from the world, therefore not separating yourself from others. And that the true joy in life is relationship, love, and nurturing. That is caring for other people, not judging them, seeing them for who they are and appreciating that. I think the thing that you can do is just to open up, be loving. And what I do to accomplish nurture is I just say yes. When people ask me to do things, I almost always say, yes, yes, I can do that. So enjoying people, not judging them, being kind. And one thing you can do this week is write a couple of notes to seniors who live in the community and who may feel separated from the community itself.
I am loved. Then the rainstorm came over me. And I felt my spirit break. I'd lost all my belief, you see. Realized my mistake, but time threw a prayer to me, and all around me became still. I need love, love's divine. Please forgive me now, I see that I've been blind. Give me love, love is what I need to help me know my name. Through the rainstorm came sanctuary. And I felt my spirit fly. Thank you. had found all my reality. And I realized what it takes. I need love, love's divine. Please forgive me now, I see that I've been blind. Give me love, love is what I need to help me know.
Thank you so much, Jesse Peters, for offering that piece. On Monday evening in our spiritual nurture group, the last of this series, I asked the community what they thought of when I mentioned the word nurture. And someone responded, "When I hear nurture, I think love in and love out." There's a verse in our ancient book of scripture that is known all around the world. It's become a part of common vernacular even. Some people know it as the golden rule, treat others as you wish to be treated. And we call it the greatest commandment, love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love in and love out. In nurturing ourselves, we are given the capacity to nurture others, and in nurturing others, we are given the courage to continue to nurture ourselves. So my prayer for you in this community this week is that you risk putting rain into practice in your life, even in the smallest of ways, and that in that final step, you love yourself as your neighbor. And I know well how hard you try to love your neighbor. So give that back to yourself this week. And honestly, these days, it is saying so much that we try to love our neighbor so well. So again, give that to yourself, that kindness, that generosity, give that nurture to yourself. And I pray that you recognize the grace that we are taught in the stories of Jesus. I pray that you allow the love of God to surround you, that you investigate the ways that the Holy Spirit is working in your life, remembering that you are an image of the divine. Go with that promise of nurture. Peace be with you.
Why should I feel
discouraged. Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for him and home when Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know that he watches over me. Let not thy heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on his my doubts and fears. Though by the path he leadeth, but one step I may see, that his eye is on the sparrow. Watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches over me. I sing because I'm happy.
Something I can do to change what's coming.